Now, you cannot
the question I'm putting forward to you now is that why have you refused to initiate criminal proceedings, criminal prosecution against people indicted by the government in power?
The process has been initiated in respect of all the cases of indictment, or perhaps in the respect of cases where you feel or there is a feeling of a prima facie, serious suspicion of a commission of an offense. There is no single case, indictment that has been overlooked by the government. So what perhaps maybe you need to know is that in respect of all the cases generally, the process is ongoing. It's not an overnight affair.
But it's looking slow because it's running for over a year now.
Well, if you are now looking at it from the point of whether it is slow or it is not, that is why I cited an example of a case relating to the Abacha loot in respect of which American government has, as recent as last week, requested for mutual legal assistance as it relates to the prosecution of the case. This is a 20 years investigation that has been on. So you cannot just go to court for the purpose of going to court, but you must do your homework to ensure at the end of the day, the field is covered for the purpose of securing conviction. And at the end of the day, if there is no prima facie case, you cannot just go to court for the fun of it. You go to court when there exists a prima facie case justifying the prosecution, justifying the possibility of securing conviction at the end of the day. And those processes, in respect of all the cases you can think of, are on, are never suppressed, and then it's a work in progress, and that is how it should naturally be. But we cannot be pushed into going to court when the ground is not settled as it relates to investigation, as it relates to the likelihood of securing conviction at the end of the day.
You don't think justice delayed is justice denied?
Well, justice delayed, particularly when you are talking of individual rights, for example, it could be justice denied, but within the context of criminal prosecution, it is the position of the law is clear. It is better to set 99 people free than to convict one single innocent soul.
I think the federal government, in its wisdom, realizing some of this bottleneck, initiated the executive order number 6, which talked about the voluntary declaration of offshore assets. How has that helped in the dispensation of criminal justice?
Well, the appreciation of the federal government, particularly as it relates to Executive Order Number 6, is the fact that those involved in higher profile cases have been working towards a kind of prostrating the prosecution, the expeditious prosecution of high profile cases. There are cases that have been fending for over a period of 10 years without moving an inch. And the mind of the federal government arriving therefrom is because, one, the undertones are economic. Two, they command a lot of resources, which resources are linked to the alleged offense that is being prosecuted. And then arising from the fact that their economic capacity has not in any way been undermined, they now constitute a serious problems in terms of expeditious determination of the cases. So arising therefrom, since the undertone is economic, the mind of the government is there is need, one, to ensure at the end of the day that they are denied the opportunity of accessing the resources at their disposal that constitute the subject of investigation, also the subject of prosecution. And perhaps if you succeed in doing that, and coupled with the fact that you succeed in restricting the movement of the accused concerns, they will be more interested this time around, not in compromising the expeditious determination of the cases, but they will be more interested in ensuring the speedy determination of these cases. Thereby, they will no longer be interested in coming off with frivolous applications that keeps slowing down the wheel of justice. So the essence of Executive Order Number 6 is to attack the economic undertones that constitute the source of strength, the source of desire of the
accused persons in terms of slowing down the process of the process of judicial determination of cases to ensure at the end of the day that they are placed in such a position that they will as well key into the understanding of the expeditious determination of cases. That is the essence of Executive Order Number 6.
But looking at the implication of this executive order now, isn't that likely going to place an untold burden on, in terms of having multiple taxation, both from home and their properties abroad?
Multiple taxation as well.
That is, the abroad government would be taxing them, while the home government too will be taxing them. Is it really right? Is it really proper to tax people who have assets abroad?
Well, I don't know whether you are talking of Executive Order Number 8 in these circumstances or you are talking of Executive Order Number 6. But if you are talking of the Executive Order Number 6, in stricto sensu, the position remains clear that what is being targeted by the order is the subject matter of criminal litigation, criminal prosecution. So if that is the case, when a subject matter has been submitted to the court for the purpose of prosecution, the idea of tax does not come into place until after the determination of the subject matter of litigation.
No, I'm talking about the window given to people who have assets offshore to declare their assets and for government to tax them abroad.
Well, as a Nigerian, you understand the operative consideration as far as the tax is concerned is the law. So in whatever respect, in whatever asset that constitutes a bone of contention as it relates to tax matters, our consideration is our law, and we have to look at it within the context of the law to see whether your assets abroad constitute an asset that is liable to the payment of tax. So it is a matter of law and not a matter of exclusive discretion of the government.